Welcome back, everyone, to the Intel Extreme Masters. We have already started our second match of the day, and Ever is currently leading 1-0 over H2K. But before we go into game number two, our gentleman Yamato has a message for everyone here on the desk.
It is something that has been pissing me off for a very, very long time.
Okay.
It's like the way people have looked at Forgiven. Because in his history, in Copenhagen Bulls and SK as well, he's been able to 1v9. Pretty much.
Yeah.
In theory, he's been able to 1v9. And with that in mind, it is like the game has developed to a point where it's so reliant on every single aspect of the team. It's like a house with five pillars. That is why we don't see your favorite player 1v9ing anymore, simply because the game has changed where everyone affects the map. So when people tell me that Forgiven has gotten worse, he got worse at Gambit, it makes very, very little sense, because to me, on Gambit, he was still playing very, very well, but the game has developed to the point where 5v5 and everything around the 5v5 as a team is super, super important. That's why your favorite player is not 1v9ing anymore. As like back in Season 3, Faker was 1v9ing, Uzi was 1v9ing, all over the place, yeah. People 1v9ing. It doesn't exist anymore. It's a team game.
That's true, and we're seeing that. You know, the stronger teams now, you think about it, it's because they have like three strong players and two players who know how to work around those three, or two and three, whatever the balance may be. And that's kind of the credit we also gave to, Forgiven, himself yesterday, said he worked with the team and kind of just plugged himself right in where they needed him. But we're going to jump right into picks and bans here for game number two. So we'll have to find out if H2K can brush the faults they may have had in game one. And already, like you guys mentioned, Lulu and Gangplank having to be banned out.
They have to be banned. And I mean, I think right now, what are you banning as H2K? You have like one ban left. There's like Ryze, there's Mundo, there's Kindred, there's...
I think you need to go for Bard. The Bard.
Bard.
Bard, leave Bard. A lot of things open. I think ESC Ever here is going to just go for the Mundo, based on their priority.
Yeah. Hide it again. We've seen they know how to flex pick. Pick the Mundo. Maybe like Lissandra.
Oh, the Mundo.
There's the Mundo.
Do you first pick the Bard then?
No.
I don't think so.
No, right? You don't need to.
You don't.
So Ryze, Ever has nothing to lose.
Great first pick. Like all the junglers are open right now.
The fact that this team understands that, I know we've seen so many teams like, you know, prioritize the Alistar because they want to get their playmaker. They think that it's a champion. Everyone's
right.
Like, no, Ryze is the broken champion. That's the priority pick. If it's not Ryze, if Mundo was left open, I'm sure we would have seen a Mundo. They're not going to say, okay, our guy's a really good Bard player. Screw it. Yeah. Ryze.
And the question is now, like H2K, the response to this should usually be Lissandra. They haven't shown in this tournament that they play Lissandra. They have banned it a couple of times. That's
okay.
The question now that I want to pose.
All right. Well, we'll have to see. I mean, there are again, so many options still on the board in terms of the junglers. Do you just want to show your jungler first? Do you want to pick up something because it's a little bit stronger for you and your team? And of course, kind of what cards you want to show, especially being on red side, they do have that advantage of being able to use those flex picks to their advantage.
I think this is correct.
This is correct because I'm pretty sure that Ever would have just picked up the Lissandra the next rotation and then still flex it to the top and bot to the mid lane. And Shen, of course, H2K is like trying to have the same approach of hiding picks as long as possible. But I'm not sure if we actually like Bog and Kindred here. Okay, Alistar is a really good pick right now that they can just pick. But they just, okay, and they decide to go with Rek'Sai.
Okay.
Maybe.
It's the same idea of the global pressure. The fact that Shin's being used as a flex. We saw Shin being picked up by Cloud9, but they would pick it in tandem with the supports. You knew that the Shin was going to that top position. By using Shin in a support position and then picking up double teleport, you effectively have three globals. So to immediately answer that with Rek'Sai, who, if she sets up her neural network of tunnels, can answer that global pressure that you would have, you know, continue to have that strong side of the map because you can get your people over there. I expect to see more global pressure come out and for that to be Ever's calling card.
And it's like looking at HK's Sai, I think it's pretty simple to predict. I think they're going to take the jungle in shape of Elise and then maybe just pick up the Lucian once again. I don't think they need to kind of hide any cards. They need to just wait until the last pick to kind of settle their flexes that they have.
What about Nidalee, man?
Oh my God.
It's a fair
Elise. I'm happy to finally see Elise here.
There you go.
For the first time.
Oh, and reverting to the Tristana for Forgiven. I mean,
you need a range. You can't lock in the Lucian because Ryze is like, he counters everything with short range. He always
has. The range,
has.
Yeah.
And if you pick like Vayne or like whatever like short range is, it's really, really hard to do anything against Ryze because you get one shot. So you need a bit of range. Like Tristana is probably the perfect pick into like the Ryze, and it's like the correct choice here, I think.
And okay. likewise, if the Sivir goes through, offering Ryze that movement speed so he can get into range and lock someone up with the stun, that's typically why we see, you know, Janna Ryze in tandem, Sivir and Ryze in tandem.
Yeah.
Doesn't do too badly against Rissana in terms of like her satchel and having the spell shield available.
I think Sivir has a very, very decent matchup into Tristana with that in mind. That's why I just wanted him to go for the AD carry that is going to guarantee himself a proper matchup in the bot lane.
Here's the thing. If, okay, Sivir's not being locked in. I would have liked it because it would have covered the problem of having wave clear.
Mm-hmm.
If you put the Kassadin into the side lane, you just have wave clear with Sivir. But I think Kalista's also like a really good choice here, simply because of how powerful that pick. Kalista's a powerful pick that also defines like team, like she's really good at team fighting and has like great synergy, of course, with Alistar with the double knockup.
Did you blind pick Kassadin?
He's blind picking the Kassadin.
Is he serious?
Yes.
Oh yeah. My goodness. The thing is, Kassadin is super great into magic damage dealing champions.
Here's the thing.
Right. But send the Lissandra top and pick something AD. Maybe we'll see a Zed. I would see the Ryu Zed coming back.
Here's
you know?
The thing. Eva can just flex a Kassadin top lane.
Okay.
Throwback.
Right. Throwback, man. I'm not sure. I've not seen
that. Could
like,
be interesting. I didn't think about that.
Ryu wants it.
I mean, they're looking for a way to take advantage of this for Ryu.
Because Kassadin has a good matchup into Lissandra, so the Kassadin can just follow Lissandra, while Ryze can take care of all threats that are actually threatening for Kassadin in the mid lane, if it makes sense.
But the difficulty I'm thinking about Ryze in mid is like, if he's going for the physical damage carry, I don't like the Ryze, I like Riven, I prefer the Zed here, because even if they send the Ryze mid then, with the Elise, you can pressure him pretty, pretty hard there.
Oh, well, it's actually just going to be a Fizz coming out for H2K.
That's beautiful, too. Fizz does well into Fizz as well, Ryze as well. Like it.
All right.
Fizz does actually fairly fine against Kassadin, I think, because I've seen a lot of people pick Fizz into the Kassadin just because of how strong Fizz is. And Fizz has like a pretty free laning phase. That was always the weakness. And you kind of like counteract the trade-off you make with Fizz by having him farm up against Kassadin too.
It's like I've had a lot of conversation with Nuketak, who I see as a Fizz master, and he's been telling me that Kassadin does very, very well into Fizz. We saw it at Worlds.
Okay.
We saw, of course, Westor destroying Faker, but...
True, but he's also a specialty in himself, so that's a little bit... You can't read too much into that one, but we'll have to wait and see if this works out for Ryu and, of course, HK. They need it to work out because Ever currently is leading 1-0. We'll find out if the Korean team can close it out 2-0 right after this.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to the second semi-final here at IEM Kelowna. It is game number two between Ever and, of course, their opponents, H2K, who honestly, and like we said, played well, but Ever actually kind of out-finessed them even before they got onto the Rift.
Specifically, the draft phase, I thought, was pretty one-sided just because of the flexibility that Ever was able to create, so they on the red side would always have a last pick to either round out their comp or counter what the enemy was bringing. The Varus was a masterstroke. This time, we're going to have to wait for confirmation on who's in the top lane. They've gone for some very interesting decisions. Are we going to see this Kassadin top? It was actually an Athena mid champion in the Kesper Cup. He played both the Ryze and Kassadin in the mid lane. This time, one of them has to be taken to the top lane, and one of these matchups might actually be pretty hairy for these mages.
Oh, it does look like Crazy has that Kassadin, of course, but whether or not he actually goes top lane as well, it just goes deeper and deeper. It's like a flexception.
And this is definitely a game where people want to see the Kassadin fail, because if we are now once again in a situation where Kassadin is a flex pick between top and mid, the drafts, the bans, they're all going to keep coming. It's really a blast from the past that nobody wanted to see, and it's worrying times. So hopefully Kassadin falls down this game.
Remember that quite vividly, actually. Is H2K now on the red side? They are grouping up again for that ward that we saw Ever do pretty similarly here, but they already walked straight across one, so Crazy has ample warning. He'll just give that ground up here.
Going for the aggressive warding mission, you'd have to think, from H2K. We saw this come through from Everett. It did end up giving them the 2v2 they were looking for, but of course they entered lane late. Didn't end up mattering too much, but H2K basically mirroring the invade we saw on the red side from Ever last game.
Two wards placed down, and that's pretty much what you need to scout into any sort of lane assignment if anything different was going to come of this. Of course, you know, Kalista again for Lokan as well. Like you said, we talked about it in the break, Papa. One that Lokan likes to go for, is comfortable on Kalista as well. And it's also, like you said, nice for Ever to have that in the composition. So they stagger out their power spikes across their team, especially they did in last game, of course. Mundo late, Kalista a little bit earlier.
And look, you have to start adding Lokan to the list of AD carries who you just can't give Kalista away to. Bang, of course, famously professionally undefeated that champion for the longest time. And then you look at someone like OQ, a wonderful Kalista player. Lokan, he defaults this champion. And just the space, the fact that he didn't die in that last team fight before the end of the previous match shows that he's a Kalista to be feared.
And it was Lokan who actually shut him down, who ended that Bang's spree on Kalista by using Tristana there, ironically enough, forgiven having picked that one here as well. That was the end of that spree in the Kesper Cup here as well. A little bit of early aggression towards this mid lane, and it does seem like Athena going to be staying mid with that Ryze. What's your take on how this one sort of plays out here?
It's just a situation where the auto attacks are going to help out the Ryze in the early game. Seeing a lot of posturing, but not looking like any gank in the mid just yet. Fizz has kill pressure at 6, but honestly, it's a snowball lane, so it'll be interesting to see which way it goes, as there's a lot of jungle pressure and even roams coming through from both squads. As a lane swap's been successful, H2K got what they wanted, and the fast push is going to be started by H2K.
All right, Jankos there will actually about to take away the Gromp there, but you can see the key was fairly close by. So we're going deep for that camp there, as well as H2K positioning towards that tower to try and take that one down quickly, but ESC will respond to this one. Jankos has taken a little bit of damage from the blue buff, but ESC aren't looking to punish him. They're just trying to secure that one, and this might work against them if they're not careful. H2K
Ever has less numbers. Remember, they only have 3v4 in this situation. Sure, Ryze can teleport, but still very early level, so risky to contest anything, and now
Shadow Dash, Flash Pulverize going up. Oduwamne, Diz knocked in the air for quite some time. He's still alive, though, as well, able to sit back towards the outside of the fight and do some damage, and in fact, ESC just gonna back off there as well. Like you said, they didn't have the numbers.
But they didn't have the numbers yet. I can't tell if they've claimed the blue buff. It looks like it's still on the rift. So far, the lesser numbers in the turret have been sufficient at dropping the fast push coming through from H2K. Teleport comes through the bot lane. Yep. So, Ever, successful defense.
Yeah, the fact that you were able to dissuade H2K from taking that buff away with just 3 players reads a lot, I guess, into how H2K are feeling or did feel in that situation. A lot of respect being offered over here to Ever. Jankos just auto-attacking there towards Key. Bit of free damage is good damage, of course, and he actually might try and follow up on this one. The Cocoon comes in, and H2K out of nowhere going straight for Key. It's a rappel down, and the first blood goes towards Ryu. Key is a little bit too far forward.
H2K just didn't take the pedal off the metal. They very much want to pick up this blue, just because we can note that it's Crazy riding the enemy blue buff. It was donated, of course. You don't need that blue buff to jungle if you're the Rek'Sai, so donated in blue just to try and help the laning phase. Predictably not going to be so good when we're talking about top lane Kassadin. And Jankos will claim the enemy blue buff. So it took a long time. It was elongated, but successful blue buff invade after this time from H2K.
And not only the blue buff, but also that kill of Key, not realizing how far forward he was. And now Oduwamne going to be pressured by Lokan. That rend as well. Definitely going to be leaving a scratch So Duamne has to be very, very careful about how far forward he can legitimately come in this lane.
Whenever Glacial Path is down, it's going to be effectively denied for the 16 or so seconds of that cooldown, and H2K reinitiate this fast push. They have the Tristana. What has been the story from them? With Tristana and Elise, of course, who does have the Spiderlings and the W to push down turrets early. H2K, in all their victories, in fact, in all their games so far, barring the last outing, have focused on turret pushing with Tristana. That has been Forgiven's game. It's more of a thankless task. You don't see the big KDA numbers that kind of typify the community's perception of Forgiven, but it's been pretty damn effective most of the time. So returning to that game makes a lot of sense. And remember, fast push against Kasten, fast push against low wave clear in general. You know, apart from Desperate Power being activated, there is little to no wave clear on the side of Everyone. We didn't actually notice it. Athena has had to take Exhaust, so there's no double teleport, and that means I have to feel that the lack of wave clear is going to be a big issue.
Keep our eyes on that one there as well. And just the little tells coming away from Ever as they try and hold back any sort of pushes coming towards them are going to tell a lot of that story and maybe illustrate that point a little bit further for you, Papa. But now we have Loken and Key towards his bottom side, and we do have Forgiven there as well. So we may be seeing the 2v2 as Vander does traipse his way down the river to join in on this one. And both of those AD carries, comparable CS totals. In fact, the biggest deficit we're seeing is between Athena and Ryu, who's been kept to 20 CS in the mid lane.
That's the reality of a range versus melee matchup. Ryu's not level 6. In fact, he's level 4. He's 2 levels behind. He went for the invade, fell low during that, had to back, didn't have teleport himself. The result is a big mismatch in terms of experience in the mid lane. Jankos is coming up.
Down again. Could be pretty potent here if Jankos wants to come in. It's a flash. Kakuna Matata, no worries, mate. Ares is going to get chopped straight down. Odoamne trying to back away there, and Jankos stands in between the two of them. Crazy wants to flash forward and trying to get the kill here. And Odoamne, yes, the Ring of Frost comes out. He keeps a distance from Crazy. Crazy can't reach him with the Void Pulse. And there it is. Jankos will get the execute.
Really smart passing from Jankos. Threw a pink ward, came in with the flash, was aggressive in his movements. This is the Jankos that we saw confidently putting Rush in his place in the Lee Sin versus Nidalee rematch in the third match yesterday. Very nice play, and this Kassadin, you know, this is what we're talking about. Kassadin in the off lane and the long lane, especially pre-Rift Walk. He did a lot of respectable damage, but went down, and suddenly, early snowball advantage squarely with H2K.
This is what we were talking about last game, Papa. H2K didn't play a bad early game at all. In fact, it was good. There was early games coming away from Jankos, and he's now emulating that again here. Already 100% kill participation. He's been everywhere over the map. He's opening up opportunities for H2K to eke out these small leads, and they will hope, I'm sure. And as things get a little bit later on, they're not going to be pressured. There's no double teleport again, as you said, forever. But Vander might be caught here in the bush. Yes, the knock up, the flash forced.
Yeah, and we'll get into the double teleport when we have time. The ticking time bomb's not quite the same. It's not quite Dr. Mundo, but Kassadin, if he can somehow pick up farm, I guess pretty easy post six when he's hard to gank, he will be a bit of a ticking time bomb. Ryze and Kassadin have some of the highest single target and even many times AoE damage that you can possibly get out of mages. There's a huge amount of damage, and Loken will of course have the earlier power spike, Kalista coming through to do respectable damage himself. The damage is super high this game from Ever. So once again, H2K, they're gonna probably focus on the turret destroying, and they wanna keep the accelerator, keep the pedal on it as long as possible, because there's still plenty of impressive scaling on the side of Ever.
Are you concerned about Ryu here right now being so far down in CS? He does have the kill that alleviates that discrepancy a little bit more, but would you as H2K have a furrowed brow upon seeing that?
Well, he's now hit level 6, and you have to remember that all the pressure that's been caused by his roam, by his invader, and picking up the first blood with the flash. You know, okay, he's missed out on CS, but the map control is getting further and further into the hands of H2K. And at some point, it's gonna be hard for Ryze to overextend for CS. This is a champion that can be easily ganked, easily dived by Lissandra and Elise, two champions that can go invulnerable, two champions that can easily go over walls. The implied pressure will exist now that level 6 is hit and that the map is so squarely controlled in the top lane for H2K. So on the surface, yes, you should be concerned when you're that far behind in CS. But with what H2K has been able to get as Fizz has sacrificed CS, it shouldn't be a problem for much longer, just given all the pressure coming through from H2K.
Seems like it's not just interviews that Jankos shows no respect in. And look at how deep he is. Look at how happy he's been to trace through this part of the jungle. The waters are chummed, and the Shadow Dash goes on towards Athena. And Ares is taking a lot of damage. He has to Frozen Tomb himself. But Jankos now a target of the tower. We did, of course, see that Shen drop. Vander went to the tower.
Raptors.
Jankos, oh, not quite. I think he'll just escape there. But it was a close one. A one-for-one trade overall. but definitely as HTK were the instigators, it really seemed like a clear advantage to them after that.
It was just key. This is a guy whose bard is what wowed us back in Kasper Cup, but the fact that he had rotated to the mid lane, predicted this dive, you know, we were talking about it, so we knew it was going to come eventually, but Key, he was right on the time. I was there. He's there again, actually. Key is just smartly in this situation, understanding that the 1v1 between Kalista and Chitana is fine, and just trying to relieve pressure from the rise, because the implied pressure became real pressure, but not quite a kill advantage for HTK.
The prescience from Key so far has been immaculate. We'll have to see if he is going to continue to be in those important spaces here, as obviously HTK are looking to isolate single champions, and Jankos is just out for blood. Still 100% kill participation with those three assists. And now, I mean, we went away from forgiving a little bit there, of course, as Action went down in the mid lane, but, you know, he's just doing the solid job here. Again, rarely do we see him down in CS. I think we saw him yesterday at one point in one of the games. He was down a little bit, but he seems to have been transitioning fairly comfortably through the early game now as well. Have to be careful, though, of course, as Flex Call is available for Loken, but won't be used.
Yeah. Also worth noting that, as expected, both Athena and Crazy are going to be investing in scaling. Rod of Ages is powerful in this patch. We're still talking about better immediate power than before, but still, of course, more focusing on the 10-minute mark once those items are completed. So, Lissandra going for Rod of Ages herself, but Ryu already has the Abyssal Scepter, and it's certainly not from CS. That's definitely from the kills he's managed to pick up. Athena will pick up a blue buff, but look for H2K to continue playing around the mid lane, because it doesn't matter what the CS values are. If you're even levels with an Abyssal Fizz, the kill pressure is immense onto this rise.
Ryu is going to continue to make himself relevant now, especially off the back of what you just pointed out, having that item already in his inventory, of course. And for Athena, well, your rise, you got to build up a little bit slower. And there's the chum, the water's coming out as well. Athena's under with his tower, but it doesn't seem to care. Well, it doesn't seem to matter, should I say, to H2K as they go in for that one. And a teleport forced by Crazy, and he gets there as the dust settles, no one to be seen. And there's the knock-up as well. Forgiven in that bottom lane, it's going to be a teleport coming in here for H2K. Fate's cool. He's pulled out here, and Key goes back in. He gets the knock-up for Given Evander. The teleport was cancelled. Beautiful read there from ESC. They won't get the kills, but you can see these guys, there's something happening in those brains, no doubt about it.
I mean, the fact that they won the trade of summoners. Remember, flash and teleport used from HK for nothing. Literally only the Fate's Call used. Very smart re-engage from Ever. They won that little skirmish. The teleport's now down. No teleport advantage because Crazy teleported into mid. H2K, let's be fair though. They're squarely in control of this game. Up in kills, up in a lot of gold. The scaling items haven't been started. It looks like H2K have at least a 10 to 15 minute window of dominance, and it's up to them to just close out this game, because right now, the early game, specifically Jankos' very smart pathing, has put them well on top of Ever.
He's still continuing to be involved in every single kill that happens on the Rift. Such a key player, of course, coming across with Evander from Rockout, and those two definitely have given a new look to H2K and a new lease on their performances here. You and Jankos there as well towards that middle side. It's a pink ward to be placed down, and I want to see them really get aggressive. We know what H2K can do when they get that aggression going. You talked about a window. They have time. They have a power play, if I wag my fingers and use that term loosely. Loken was looking for Vander. Yeah, straight with the Shadow Dash, but this could get dangerous here. Key looking towards that bottom side, but Ever just trying to be a bit more conservative here.
I mean, this is where Ryu will start to catch up in CS or even get ahead, just because if any friends go off the map, whether it's Lissandra or Lise, if they're not accounted for, Abyssal Scepter plus the magic damage coming in from either of those champions, doesn't matter that it's not a Runeglaive Lise, it's just a Cinderhulk Lise and a Rod of Ages not fully stacked from Lissandra. Abyssal Scepter fizzes natural damage, the damage amp from the ultimate, that will be a dead Ryze. So Ryze's access to safe farm is being squarely held down from the Fizz pick and the smart itemization from Ryu.
We're given now just aggression towards Loken in the bottom lane. He's been happy just to stay there, really. I mean, just getting his farm up. Loken has kept himself fairly close as well. So you can see that neither AD carry is willing to get their opposite number, get ahead in any sort of meaningful manner. In the middle, we are seeing that pressure applied now, as well as that ladder turret. Still looking pretty good. A couple scratches being applied there as Ever. You know, there's almost a sense of uncertainty there for them as well. Not sure how deep they're willing to go here. H2K definitely looking a lot stronger, galvanized from a very good few ganks coming in from Jankos here. And you're right, they're looking in control, but it's how they now capitalize and how they manifest their gold advantage or their kill advantage into something we can see on this map.
And things definitely haven't gone, look, they've probably gone worse for Ever than expected, if you are Ever, but they haven't gone awful. Remember, you locked in top lane Kassadin. You're not expecting to be winning the early game. You knew things were going to be slightly hairy. You're still getting farm over to Athena. That's the important fact. The fact that he cultivated that early CS advantage means that now that he's missing, say, 2 or 3 CS every couple of minion waves, not as big of a factor keeping 30 CS advantage over in the mid lane. Eva, they're just trying to stem the bleeding, and it's on H2K to keep pushing it. Items like Abyssal, champions like Elise and Lissandra can take hold of this game. We're going to finally see a dragon come down. Such a different game, remember? It was a 22-minute third dragon in game one. And 15 minutes in, no team's even started this objective yet.
So 2.4k gold lead towards H2K, and it's almost as if they heard you, Papa. They're going to take away this first dragon. Talking about H2K having an early advantage, don't want to harp on it, but how specifically do you think they'll be looking to actually capitalize on that? Because you talked before, dragon, yeah, brilliant. You get your first dragon, one is all you really need for both sides. Where do they actually start to now make their presence and advantage felt?
I mean, you noticed Jankos doing it, what, 5, 6 minutes ago when they basically took a stranglehold over the top side of the jungle. Now, smartly, they're taking a stranglehold over the bottom side of the jungle. When they had the top side of the jungle, we said, okay, now Ryze can't safely farm because at any point could be turret dived by either Elise or Lissandra. Now that they're putting all their members towards the bottom side, there should be less free farm. Basically, wherever either of these carries, all three of them, are getting access to safe farm, they should be attacking. And it's on someone like Key, on the Alistar, to try and relieve pressure, as we're going to see lots of cross-map movements from H2K to just try and get this outer ring of turrets completely down.
And it's a void rush actually towards the middle side here for Ares. So straight away, you know, Eva aren't looking to contest that one. They knew how many members of H2K were moving down towards the bottom side, and they give that ground. Maybe they have to respect that. They have to understand that they know they're not ahead in this one here, and they need to bide their time and strike when the time is right.
Squarely behind, but definitely by a much larger margin. They were actually slightly ahead even with their scaling Mundo comp in the previous game. This game, they're behind as they should be. Actually a bit forward of Ares to be so far forward against a Abyssal Scepter Fizz, but they're going to try and keep holding on their waves. It's the mid tower that, of course, gives you the most vision, so taking that down, letting the minions push aggressively into mid would give H2K all the answers. It's now on Eva to just keep rotating members. It's going to almost be a supporting cast of members for Athena to walk into mid and try and keep this outer turret up. Buy time for these double Rod of Ages to start scaling. Buy time for this Tia. Ryze, you know, Tia, Rod of Ages, this is what he's all about, but it's still scaling for days, only if we get to the 27-30 minute mark.
See Eva now actually prioritizing here, getting good amounts of farm flowing through. Crazy has himself a farm lead over Oduwamne. Yes, of course, as we talked about, Athena is ahead of Ryu, and Forgiven is actually the only member of H2K in that meaningful role that does have a meaningful CS lead, and it's been shortened by a great deal here. So Eva, they're not extending for too much. It's like they have an understanding of exactly what they have the capacity to achieve at this current time, and they're sticking to that. That's discipline as well as good foresight. It's crazy, and Oduwamne in the top side. Harry sitting back here as well. He was hoping maybe for Oduwamne to come forward and catch himself out. It's a long cooldown on the glacial path, but Oduwamne doesn't go in.
And you know, Yamada Kano was mentioning it. There's been a lot of talk among analysts that Kassadin's actually a pretty good matchup against Lissandra. Maybe that's why we're starting to see it, the Lissandra flicks. This is what they went for. They knew they didn't have the best options for the Ryze, but they thought, okay, let's get Kassadin the matchup. Focus on Kassadin getting the matchup. And even though he was denied so much CS, was behind in CS early in the game, suddenly cultivated 17 CS advantage. There's not much kill pressure from the Lissandra, barring a lot of help from multiple members from H2K. Kassadin's farming up, and that's the only worry here. The one thing that H2K hasn't done that I would have liked to see with just the pressure of the Abyssal Scepter, Fizz, and Jankos being well on top of Ares would be controlling the blue buff, because only with blue buff does Athena really have the ability to use Desperate Power to clear waves every, say, 2 or 3 minion waves. If they had also controlled that blue, it would have been that much harder, and we would have expected, say, 15, 14 minutes for this outer turret to come down rather than now, where it's still going to be alive, theoretically, at 20 minutes time.
And you highlighted that lack of wave clear on Eva. You said this could be an issue for them. Athena needs a blue buff, like you said, to have some wave clear. Without it, it's so much harder to actually counter this push that is currently going on. Talked about Ryu getting involved. He at least went towards the bottom side here as well, but he's not going to find too much, as Loken giving him plenty of respect. Ryu just checking, see if there's any recalls happening behind that tower.
I mean, the Fizz, he's certainly not a champion that you can really walk up to if you're a Kalista. Has a lot of outplay, but, you know, the fish comes down. It's going to be a dead Kalista, squished into the ground. So going to have to rotate someone to the bottom lane. It's almost like Ryze is on duty. And look, smart pickup here. He's actually going for the QSS to just have a hope in hell of being able to buy time to farm against this Fizz.
Forward thinking there from Athena. Let's see if it pays off. Key does go in there as well. Does get one pulverized. It's an immediate rocket jump away from Forgiven. Normally, it's the other direction, Forgiven going in here. But he himself has been disciplined in this game, just doing what he believes or his team believes needs to be done. And what might have been our first proper fight of the game fizzles out into, well, just some pleasantries exchange.
And just worth knowing that Ryze wasn't grouped, so that was definitely, it was up there with the fake Thresh lanterns where you throw out a lantern, baiting them into thinking you have allies when you don't. It was just literally buy more time for this outer turret. It's going to fall soon. We noticed it's at what, maybe 20% health. Forgiven, he's not leaving this mid lane until he's got that structure or he's dead. So either way, going to keep anchoring themselves in mid. And the inevitable will come soon, and that will be three outer turrets down forever.
I mean, you know, yeah, with Key going in for the Pulverize, there was always Fate's Call available sure, just in case the proverbial was going to hit the fan. So Key didn't mind too hard, too much about going forward. But Ryu, on the other hand, might have other ideas. He's just making his presence known that Chum the Warders is available. So if he wants to go in for the throat here, again, just dancing around. Playful tricks to back up. But that pressure, the push is coming in. It's bit by bit. It's a war of attrition. The H2K have all the tools to come out on top.
It's just really a small, subtle thing, but it was nice watching Key. He literally would juke forward and back as the Fizz walked up just to ensure that he was going to body block the ultimate there. Just smart little positioning thing. It might sound like just an obvious thing, but I try and give my tip of the hat to Key when I can, because this guy, whether it was on the Bard or smart moves last game on the Shen, this is the guy. I'm going to make a big proclamation here. I think the Key is the most impressive support prospect since the days of Marta and Peekaboo. Ooh, this guy has so much potential to be a top support. Will we see him in Champions next season? As of right now, maybe not. But either way, Key has been the untold story of the offseason.
Top-ranked member of his team on the Korean solo queue ladder, and actually only one of three of them that are in challenges. So
MVP of the Kasper Cup as well.
Absolutely. Had an amazing game as well, and he was giving Bang nightmares for a while after that, I'm pretty sure. Went like 14 or so assists, no deaths or something crazy. But speaking of crazy, in the top lane is Odawamne. Bit of a Ring of Frost there as well. It's going to be the Frozen Tomb to come down on Crazy as well. Look at all the damage he's trying to put across, but it's not going to be enough. Crazy is going to finish things up with a Null Sphere. But Vander at least managed to get on site and claim one back for H2K.
Worth knowing that was the absolute last half second of the channel. Janko's getting aggressed on, but Aries doesn't quite have any backup just yet. That was the last half second channel of the Stallion. It almost didn't complete. He almost killed him through the ultimate. And you can tell that as the items start to roll and as the Rod of Ages start to stack up, okay, that's a one for one, but would the extra resource use ever pick up a dragon? And next time, when the ult's down or when a bit more AP is stacked, I don't think the Stallion Knight Shield is going to be enough to save Odawamne.
That has got to be a grim omen, I think, especially for H2K there as well. They have to be aware of that. But of course, still, as you said, feeling in the driver's seat at this stage, and ESC now starting to bare their teeth a little bit more, looking for those fights in lanes. And they, you know, we're seeing those Rod of Ages having been completed. And as you said, Athena got his QSS. It's also an Abyssal Scepter now for Crazy. So some of those important items are coming in for these scaling champions.
They definitely are. Athena, he's going to be late on his big items, of course. Just sitting on the tier still, so 25, 26, 30 minutes for the completed Seraph's Embrace when that comes through. Still going to keep picking up the blue buffs, going to keep scaling up. The big question to me is, can Athena actually stand against a split-pushing Ignite Lich Bane Fizz? I'm going to guess no, even with the QSS, maybe with some sick outplay. I can't really see it, but Athena's just trying to do his best. He doesn't have teleport, so there's another situation. Ryu is going to continue the split-push himself. It's going to take multiple members to stop this Fizz, I'd have to think.
Tension is brewing. You can feel it right now. This game building up to a fever pitch, and we will eventually hit that critical mass. And one of these two teams, well, it's going to be a big advantage from them once we break through that important climactic point. ESC, almost a sense that they're readying themselves up here as well. And Jankos, well, not surprised to see him spending time in that blue side jungle again. It's just being able to get on towards those camps and just disrupt, I guess, the transfer of buffs going in towards Ever as well. A constant thorn in the side. It's diligent work from him. And it's honestly contributing to H2K being in front right now.
It's diligent work, but it hasn't been quite the result I would have expected. Remember, at 10 minutes, they controlled this top lane jungle. Since then, every blue buff has been claimed by Ryze. Ryze hasn't been turret dived ever since we saw Ryu and Jankos go for the brute force dive on him in mid. Ryze has surprisingly managed to cultivate still a 30 CS advantage, despite the fact that at different points, both his top lane and bottom lane jungle is going to be in a complete no-go area. So it's one thing to invade smartly, that part absolutely A-plus by Jankos, but actually translated that into picking up those buffs, that's what's been the missing piece of the puzzle for H2K.
Well, we had to wonder how H2K's advantage was going to manifest itself, and maybe it just hasn't. Fate's Call's going to come in, Oduwamne already going to use a Glacial Path to get out, but Oduwamne will be caught there as well. It's going to be the knock-up and the Frozen Tomb used on towards Loken and a Shadow Dash. They're keeping the Kalista CC down for quite some time, but he's able to sustain through it. H2K flanking off towards the side, surely looking for Loken at one point, but Oduwamne will fall, and Crazy, he wants a better Jankos as well. Riftwalk will come out, a Force Pulse to slow the man up. Crazy, well, it's going to be very, very hard for Jankos to escape his inevitable fate, and even Vander as well, very, very close to being taken away. He actually had the Shadow Dash, he was actually hit by the Prey Seeker, but not quite enough damage to get it done. And here's a response from H2K, working on those turrets.
Really smart move from H2K. They note the fact it's not double teleport there against, it's low wave clear light we mentioned, and only an exhaust taken from Ryze. I don't know if we've even seen. Okay, Ever's the one raising the ante. This has turned into an all-in from Ever. They understand they've got three picks. They just saw two members bot with no teleport to free Baron. Very smart, decisive call from Ever.
Yep, this, you know, tense standoff has now hit that critical mass, and we're starting to see the ball really start to get rolling. And ESC, other ones almost feeling like they're in the driver's seat, especially their response to that turret being taken away. Let's take Baron. Let's really turn it up to 11 here and start to apply pressure to all of these lanes. And they're going to start with the top.
It's finally going to be a no turret, a no damage turret, now going to, of course, be completely taken down by both the AD carry and the Baron buff minions coming through. Kasten hadn't really prepped that at all. And this situation going to be fine. Wow, okay, that back buff, that back timer did come through. Ryu has plenty of mobility himself, and Crazy, he's dead.
Yeah, Crazy's just going to get caught up here as well. Riftwalk, not enough to get him out, and Ryu will be able to pick him up, taking one of those Baron buffs away from Ever and H2K as well. They want to respond. They're not going to be left in the dust here, and they're looking towards a turret. It's already been taken away. Ever only have one turret over the course of 26 minutes.
But isn't it fun to see these decisive League of Legends? First, the decisive picks come through, and then Forgiven says, okay, my team's going to lose this skirmish. Let's go bot and pick up this turret, take that turret, then the decisive calls take Baron, and the chase continues. So it's definitely been A to B to C to D. Ever slightly in the advantage because they pick up the Baron, but still in a hole in terms of gold. And still, once this Baron buff fades, if H2K gets some picks, they could end this game.
Key getting pushed on here as well, but Ryu wants other targets. He's looking for Loken, and he might just have him. Frozen Tomb is used, and Oduwamne is going to take him out. Ryu forced towards the backside here, but Loken being down. We'll see how this happens. But Athena, he's got himself on towards that site now. They're restarting the shot coming in from the Sandra, and Jankos is going to be caught. One-on-one with Ryze, not a man you want to meet down a dark alley, or even a well-lit one, to be fair. And the blue man will get the kill.
Yeah, the turret dive was not necessarily advised. They almost picked up a kill and got out, but they couldn't quite do it. No reset on the rocket jump coming through from Justana. Some exit kills come out, and what could have potentially been a couple of picks and breaking the base even against Baron buff from Ever is counted. So we're going to see the replay coming through. You can see why they're going through. The moment the Shen channels, though, they're going through the dive on Loken. They think they can take him out. They layer the CC, but not ideal. The first cleanse is enough. Loken dies, but Ryze, he's jogging there. Vanessa power is activated, flashes for the first kill, gets another. They hold on to the turret, and nothing more comes as Athena.
Forgiven's going to be completely caught out there as well. He was so far forward, and now Oduwamne is well going to be surrounded. HTK going for the dive. The response was reasonable. It was a 2-for-2, but somehow they find themselves in enemy territory, and ESC were just ready for them to walk into the trap.
And the moment you walk into a trap that involves a Rod of Ages, Seraph's Embrace, Ryze, and Kassadin, who's been basically free farming the top 209 CS, 15 ahead of Lissandra. Both these mages, very high damage carries, are online.
I tell you what, this gold lead is now going to be diminishing. In fact, it will always be non-existent after that turret is taken. H2K have had their opportunities. They're still looking good, but they're getting picked off there, of course, as Oduwamne and Forgiven, two very, very crucial champions here off the map for a while. As you said, mid-game, these death timers are really quite oppressive, but now it's even opened up a dragon forever.
And the long death timers means finally picking up some of that global gold they've been smarting on. Of course, now turrets give so much more global gold than they used to. That big gold lead was 5,000 a couple of seconds ago, suddenly will go over and it's only 2,000, and it will continue to narrow. If they pick up these two answering turrets, it's for you.
He's going to go in. The waters are chummed. Athena's going to use the Seraph's Embrace. He actually fancies to hang around. Not sure why He's a three surrounding him here. I don't think he'll even be able to get one kill away. This is Ryze. He's the desperate power, allowing him to sustain through a lot of that damage. The playful trickster is always going to be available there for Ryu. Just a strange scene there as well. But you're seeing just a glimpse of how scary that Ryze is going to be as his game continues.
If there was two, maybe he could have pulled off some shenanigans with the QSS. But three confirmed that it was going to be a pick. But what does the pick mean? Remember, we just saw all three of those people back. So they're not going to get any structures. They already had the inner turret down. It's always nice to pick up extra kill credit. But no more objectives gained. Baron's off the map, Dragon's off the map, inner turrets are down. It's going to be breaking these outer turrets, these inhibitor turrets, sorry, for H2K, but only when they're grouped and Forgiven's free autoing are they realistically going to pick any of those up.
So let's take stock of things now as the dust starts to settle a bit.
Yeah. We've had a lot of action.
I need plenty of those, to be fair. I mean, we've got some, you know, there's items now being finished off. Ryu actually has his death cap as well as his Lich Bane, so he's really starting to look scary. And H2K as well, fighting over the Raptors. I mean, any other notable sort of pickups item-wise or spikes we're seeing here, Papa?
I mean, Fizz has finished his death cap. This is Assassination through and through. QSS be damned. You're dead if this guy gets on top of you and hits any semblance of a combo with the ultimate. This also means his split pushing is super good. Interested to see what Fizz versus Kassadin looks like. People have said this is a sort of lame matchup that you can navigate through if you're Kassadin, but certainly not great. What does it look like later in the game when the items start to be put together? Abyssal Scepter's complete. I don't think we're going to see Crazy try and bite off more than he can chew. If he goes down with Teleport up against Ryu's Ignite, then that's going to be a big strategic hole for Ever to try and fill.
We're seeing a lot of skirmishing happening here in general. We're not seeing full-scale 5v5s. Both of these teams as well are, you know, making decisive moves in towards fights when they sort of think that's appropriate. Do you think that benefits both of these teams here as well, just going for these little picks? And what do you reckon, I mean, a 5v5 is going to benefit more?
I mean, you look on H2K's side. Let's talk about the duos they have. We already saw the mid lane, Elise and Op. Is.
Just Forgiven things. Going towards Ares and the cocoon does catch him as well. It's a pickup and a very important one there for H2K, who kind of threw themselves away earlier on with a couple of picks that they gave to Ever, but that's an important one there. Jungler is down.
And spared my blushes, showing you that the pick power of the likes of, say, Elise Fizz or Lissandra Elise, the pick power of the 2v2s is much stronger for H2K. The 5v5, okay, they can get things done. Okay, they have a frontline, the likes of Shen Ultimate to help them out. But 5v5 should be Ever's playhouse. But in a 5v4 situation, H2K, they're desperate to break the base here.
And looking impressive in this moment, H2K coming forward and definitely putting a bit of sweat on the brow of Ever here. Oh, this is the classic gank bush, of course, Ryu there. His ward is going to be spotted out fairly quickly, and he'll have gone to an adjacent bush and hope for something similar there as well. H2K valuing heavily still that vision in the jungle. You can see backing away now as well, and they'll take a break.
Speaking of valuations, Banshee Veil, third item coming through. Third major item coming through from Athena. Athena's just looking to be the true machine gun, 40% CDR, to stand in the Fizz damage, be the one say, okay, this certainly can't be the Kalista. I'm gonna stand there and try and tank through and heal up through the damage you put out, Fizz. So he's basically put his hand up and said, okay, I'm gonna spend this 2,700 gold or so on the Banshee Veil to allow myself to actually position aggressively, because if you don't pick up an item like that, you need to be so defensive as Ryze. You're just another potential assassination target for Ryu.
QSS in Banshee's Veil for Athena. Loken actually has a Hex Drinker and of course a Quicksilver Sash there.
Remember, QSS, Banshee Veil, the Seraph's Embrace Shield, and also the Ryze Ultimate, passive shield. Yep. He's deceptively tanky to magic damage as Ryze.
Man, like the defensive mindset there with ESC, they respect a lot of the capacity of H2K to cause carnage in these fights, but it's Ever now coming forward. They're going to have this middle inner turret as well, and it looks like they'll press up or maybe even try and take some of their own control. They haven't spent a lot of time in this part of the map, or at least in H2K's jungle in a deep fashion. So at least they'll be able to reach themselves forward, extend a bit, pop a ward or two down, and start to establish their presence here.
This might be very similar viewing to fans who watched the LeBlanc game, where Ryu basically effortlessly took them over the line against Cloud9 in Game 2 yesterday. The difference between LeBlanc and Fizz, though, is that LeBlanc can poke. LeBlanc can get in there with the Mimic Distortion and then get to safety. Only champions like Morgana and Maokai can really shut him down or make her pay for going for those sort of pokes. When you're Fizz, you're going all in or you're not poking in. So much easier to sweep out, put the blue trinkets from safety, and stop Ryu from coming in. So it's going to be an all-in or nothing for H2K to take advantage of this Fed Assassin.
No one's saying they don't have the capacity to create a fight when and where they want it here, but ESC, of course, thinking defensively, have, of course, ability to try and kite around that one, get some disengage if they need to. Headbutt is always a possibility, but Crazy comes forward instead. Just over the wall, it was a Force Pulse, but only too much damage being stuck down. But ESC, now they've shifted the gear. They're going up one as well. Now they're looking for the towers themselves. They're looking to establish dominance and control, and this ain't a bad way to do it at all.
A very easy job to do, right? Not the most turret damage, not the most range coming through on Kalista either, and Kassadin can only really fake aggression. Taking this tower will take time. Here's the engage.
They're going forward. Odawam then there as well. Laser Frozen Tomb on Loken, but he's still alive for the moment. Athena now starting to front load some of that damage. Vander has gone down. Loken's still on his feet. Crazy there gets one as well. And this is all going wrong for H2K. They had it in the palm of their head. And Ever are now taking all the game away from them bit by bit. A 3-for-none. H2K were the ones that engaged. And they fell so short of what they hoped.
He might have been exhausted, but Athena put out massive damage and did not take a speck on his health bar. It's already impressive without even talking about the Seraph's Embrace shield. They're going to keep pushing. The attack speed's there from Loken. The base is going to be broken. There's nothing forgiven and Jankos can do to stop this inhibitor going down.
30 seconds about that on Oduwamne and Ryu here. Vander will get back to the fight fairly quick, but these death timers again proving to be so harsh, but Ever will satisfy themselves with taking away that inhibitor, whereas a couple minutes ago they were four turrets behind or so and weren't even looking like they're about to take an inhibitor. What a quick paradigm shift here coming out of Ever.
They just couldn't kill Loken. They used everything to get into that champion. He got very, very low, but then the QSS came through. Then we're talking about the Locket Shield. Actually has the Mikhail's Crucible. I think it was just completed. I don't think he had it for the previous fight. But regardless, all the heals came through. Of course, if he had had it, he would have used it. Would have been on cooldown. So didn't have that for the previous fight. But regardless, they couldn't quite kill Loken. And Athena just laughed, unloaded his damage. And that was the end of H2K.
All the way to the bank. 4-2-4 now on that rise, and a definitely respectable total of farm. Forgiven, well, doing the standard Forgiven play here as well with almost 400 CS in 36 minutes. There's a lot of gold going in his direction, but if you can't turn that around and actually make the impact with it, what's the point?
But isn't it nice that we can look at the losing team here? At the moment, it's H2K. It feels like the game's starting to fall into laps of Ever. You can't really point at anyone in H2K and say, no, you messed up. You've played really bad this game, and everyone's played their role. Jankos was very, very impressive in the early game. Okay, we can talk about maybe you didn't push it enough, but this is a big stage. This is a very important tournament. So all I can say is that H2K have played very well this series. It's going to be one of those series where even if they go down 2-0, you can have your heads held high because you've played very smart League of Legends against an Ever team that actually was swayed in the early game. Not many teams have taken it to Ever. Only, I believe it was Rebels Anarchy took a game off Ever during the entirety of the Kasper Cup.
That's right, and even as it was sort of pointed out, SKT bringing Faker in wasn't actually enough to slow them up here. And HDK, you know, I'm going to say, yeah, it's obvious, but they haven't been together long at all, and some people forget actually how much of a factor that is against ESC, who've been around as a team for so long. And speaking of ESC, they're going to go in for one here. It's Vander getting knocked up. He seems to be the target right now, and he's just going to get blown to pieces. Elsewhere, we actually saw a fight, and it was, oh my god, Forgiven getting a kill up on towards Crazy, so at least that's something for H2K. As they want to forge forward a little bit more now. Ryu's in there, spreading some damage towards Key. He goes in, gets a three-man knockout, but there's no follow-up at the moment. They're looking towards Jankos. It's Ares. He's trying to chase him, but a flash is going to come away. But Fate's call. Key gets in there. He gets a knockout, and another knockout. He's all about getting his enemies up and airborne, and Loken now being focused. Forgiven and Athena up on the side, and Athena has lost that 1v1 well and truly. Forgiven doing some serious work now. Jankos, Forgiven going forward. Forgiven getting it done. Another rocket jump. He's looking for Loken. He wants to get that finish off. It's a triple kill for Forgiven, and he wants another one. Loken may not give it to him, though. Oh, there it is, the quadra kill. For some reason, Loken has a break in stride. He opts to go for a Q, and, well, Forgiven, we'll just pick that one up.
And I think the replay will confirm, but I believe that was a delayed pentakill. Remember, he got the first kill on Kassadin before that all started. Forgiven was the real story there. We don't know how Crazy was caught. Died with Flash and Zhonya's available. But after that fight, Forgiven actually off-screen was 1v1 in this fed rise and took it out. Here we're going to see the replay. Forgiven just goes for turret damage.
Oh my god.
In this particular situation, and just dunked Kassadin. There's no other way to put it. Did not expect the damage. H2K could win off this.
They could push forward. These death times are still so high, and they're looking for that Nexus, and Crazy puts himself in the middle. It's a Zhonya's up, but it's not really going to be enough. A Force Pulse as he tries to back away with his tail between his legs. The sheepish squad of Ever have to look at this one and try and keep themselves in. Key gets the headbutt, pushing for even back, but they're looking at the Nexus. Forgiven
there.
Towards Crazy. Here's Ryze, though. He gets in there. Vander, Jankos around the side. They're trying to finish this one off, and ESC trying to hold it back, but no! H2K and take it to a game 3.
Insane ending. H2K, they ran the early game. It looked like they were going to be tied up, by Eva. It looked like it was going to be a quick 2-0, but their death timers are so damn long. Forgiven is the hero. Forgiven has just been a structure pusher for the majority of the first four games, but this game, that last team fight, this is why you pay the big bucks. This is why you take the risk on the guy with the competitive ruling just 4 months ago. Cleaned up that fight with aplomb, killed Kasten, just did damage that Kasten didn't even expect could be possible, and got them the win, and we're all square, and we may have a European team at the final after all.
Unbelievable, really. I cannot believe what we saw in those last few moments. Like you said, it was Eva making a paradigm shift from a more of a passive team to then starting to push forward, but the biggest shift definitely was coming from Forgiven there as well. Incredible stuff from him. I mean, we could harp on this one as well, but I know, of course, our experts over the desk will break this one down in just a second. But, of course, I mean, your thoughts here. I mean, you said it was all about Forgiven there as well. We're seeing a bit of a different side of him. Like, they're keeping him back as a secret weapon. I mean, will he? Is this a confidence thing? Is he going to be more aggressive now, do you possibly think? Or is it just use the panic button when you need to win the game?
I think the confidence is certainly going to be there, and the question marks will be over specifically Crazy. He died in a situation he should never have died. He's Kasten. He has Zhonya's. He died with his flash up. This is a patch where death timers are insane between 10 and 43 minutes. The death timers proved important. Remember, they just ran down mid and basically finished the game, won a team fight purely off Kasten, misfiring after some smart play from the first 35 minutes from Crazy.
Well, there you have it. Eva have let it slip, and it will be a game 3 HTK. Very, very impressive. Let's pass over to our experts now as well, because I'm sure there's plenty to sink their teeth into.
And so there we have it. We spent some time talking about Forgiven. Is it really that he's gotten worse or whatever? And he's like, eh, you know what? I think it's about time that I make sure we win. Cleans up that fight. Of course, I mean, early on, HTK was playing very well. It was more credit to Ever if they were able to take that game towards the end, how they pulled together, how they were able to last that long with the composition they had.
Yeah, I mean, I think the call out from Yamato Ken with no one can one on nine anymore, I think it doesn't hold true anymore. So Forgiven had something to prove, and that guy just played really well. And then, of course, Elise. We have seen what Jenkins did in the early game to bring H2K to a point where they can actually do stuff. The thing is, Eva's team comp with the Ryze and Kasten together, the Rod of Ages comp, after 30 minutes, they shouldn't be allowed to like lose team fights, actually. And
right.
Forgiven actually like turned everything around with that super aggressive move. And yeah, H2K just won.
I feel like the biggest reason I questioned the Kasten with the flexibility, which I didn't really see until they did it or until Dexter mentioned it, the problem with what I have with the Ryze and the Kasten in the same composition against the Elise. You're playing into a stronger jungler. It is going to be very, very hard to stay alive against something like the Fizz or the Lissandra because they are perfect to set those ganks up. But what kept him in the game throughout was the fact that Kasten's passive and the fact that magic resistance was very, very efficient towards the HQ composition. That's why I also questioned the Fizz a bit. I wanted to see the Assassin, but in the end, Forgiven took it home.
Likewise, just kind of piggyback on the back half of that, the fact that you have Kasten and that you have Ryze, and like you said, Fizz and Lissandra feeding well into those lanes. We talk about Ever needing to create a strong side of the map. And yeah, they had their bot lane with the Kalista and the Alistar and they worked together, but I think they kind of sacrificed a bit more of their strength and that flex pick there.
Mm. Also on this patch, double tier has always been like criticized to be like fairly low in terms of scaling. And especially on this patch where it's like shorter game times, it's like a lot harder to actually pull it off. So
right.
I think there might have been like a small miscalculation or something from Ever's part. Maybe didn't even take it into consideration that there might be too much pressure from the Elise in the early game to like compensate. But overall, I think, yeah, if Ever pulls it together, they probably know what they did wrong, that they need to have like a maybe even stronger side and maybe a better Midge up in the top lane or mid lane to compensate for like the slow scaling. I think they should be fine for the next game.
It could be. I mean, this is an interesting series definitely so far because of the fact that game one, Ever shows us what they're made of. Game two, we see H2K kind of fixing up the parts they needed in the picks and bans and then pulling together those win conditions they needed. Now it's down to game three. Who's going to take it between these two teams? We'll find out right after this.